So today's class is going to be dedicated to the theorization of empire by the Italian political philosopher Antonio Negri and the American literary critic and theorist Michael Hart. We have introduced it last time, and just to bring you up to speed in the sense that I'm sure you thought about everything but Negri in the intervening 10 days since we last spoke. Let me just recapitulate what we said briefly last time. So, Negri is a political philosopher who had a great role in Italian politics, not always within the boundaries of legal action. In fact, he wrote Empire while he was in jail. Because he had been indicted for the theorization behind what was termed to be terrorist activity. Even though he was never really indicted of doing physical violence to anyone or planning physical violence, he was going to be inspired of political activity that was deemed violent in its content. Hart is a much younger literary critic whom I described last time as being also a very, very clear writer, who helped Negri put his theory in words and in a form that is quite readable, which accounts, at least in part, for the success of this book, which was an immense splash. It came out in the year 2000. And if you think about it in relation to the events of 2001, of September 2001, of course, I refer to the terrorist attacks against the Twin Towers and the Pentagon in the United States, there are some elements of this book that are just eerily close to what happened. So it is interesting to think of this book in that context, the context in which September 11 had not yet happened. But this book traces in its political analysis the conditions that, in effect, would have explained it. And even more eerily, even more strangely, the way in which certainly the United States, but the Western world at large, has responded to it. And we all wish Negri and Hart were wrong, had been wrong. Unfortunately, they weren't wrong. They were right. Okay, let me recall also a little bit of the cultural context in which this book came. We spoke about it very briefly last time. This is a book that, in a certain sense, takes stock of the end of the Cold War. At the end of the Cold War, which of course meant the end of a bipolar world, a world which could have been understood and was understood through the dichotomy of capitalism, communism, right? Two opposing political systems that during the Cold War became highly ideologized. And we spoke in this class quite a bit about the role of ideology. Ideology is not just a set of ideas. It is the use of those ideas in the political arena. I even define an ideology, a weaponization of a certain set of ideas. So during the Cold War, both communism and capitalism became the ruling ideologies of a world that seemed to be divided by them into two opposing blocks. two opposing blocks that kept each other paralyzed, kept each other in check, so to speak. The idea, you know, the description of that keeping each other in check was that the Cold War avoided, you know, war through the strategy of containment of the other. In effect, we discussed how the fear of war was simply marginalized with respect to the center of what Negri and Hart would call empire. Empire is formally a decentralized structure of power. Certainly, you know, it's called the imperial power, traditionally understood as Europe and the United States. Okay, so the Cold War, which is a war without war, the most phantasmatic war of all, was in effect not the absence of war, but the marginalization of war to the periphery of the imperial setup. Okay, so at the end of the Cold War, that is usually faced with the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989, two opposing readings of the geopolitical situation came to the fore. One was the, so to speak, progressive one that dominated leftist circles. And the reading there was, well, capitalism has won, and that is really too bad. You know, we are slipping into the end of the possibility of achieving a better world. On the other hand, the conservative bloc, sort of the bloc on the right-hand side of the political spectrum, produced a number of books and theories that oftentimes go under the name of the conflict or clash of civilizations, and developed this idea that yes, in effect, capitalism has won the war, has won the Cold War, that there is no more reason to pursue a concept of history based on class struggle or the rectification of injustice through class struggle, which was, you know, the Marxist idea associated with the losing side of the Cold War, namely the Soviet Union. And from now on, instead of wars motivated around political concepts, we'll have wars or clashes motivated by cultural or identitarian issues. Okay? So clash of civilizations, right? Clash of cultures, clash of identities. And amongst the very identities that people like Samuel Huntington, political scientist from Harvard University, who actually is the coiner of his notion of the clash of civilizations. So two civilizations slash culture slash identities that Huntington isolated as being most likely in conflict with one another or Christian and Islam. Connected, this was an immensely successful depiction of the new situation of culture and politics around the world, which was popular in academic circles, certainly not the, you know, liberal ones, the very conservative ones, but even from the left, this theory was widely discussed. But not only within academic circles. In fact, a friend of the person kind of close to Huntington called Fukuyama, came up with a theory that was related to Huntington's theory, which went under the name of the end of history. And the idea here was, and it's a theory complementary to some extent to Huntington's, the idea was, well, since we understand, we have understood so far history on the Hegelian grounds, on the grounds of history progressing from one state of affairs to another state of affairs, progressing in the sense of finding more justice, finding more civilization, more human values or values that are more and more shared universally. These are, of course, also the ideals of the Enlightenment. Now that capitalism and democracy, as if the two went together necessarily, now that capitalism and democracy have really won the war, what else are we aiming at? Okay? So the end of history, which is an old Hegelian thesis, very conservative thesis, was reignited by Francis Fukuyama, who was widely read in Washington, D.C., under the banner of history having actually reached a moment of enlightenment, a moment of self-understanding, a moment of realization of the full potential of humanity for progress and, again, civilization. That's why the Clash of Civilizations thesis and the End of History thesis go together, two faces of the same coin. So this was really the quite dismal theoretical framework that empire happens to be composed within. And of course, in this framework, empire, with respect to this framework, empire represents a very spectacular break. Why? Well, because it is not pessimist, as the, so to speak, defeatist descriptions of the situation at the end of the Cold War provided by some leftist intellectuals, and is not triumphalist in the same way that Huntington and Fukuyama were triumphalists with respect to, you know, the supposed values of capitalism and democracy, and the marriage between capitalism and democracy, which is all but an evidence. So, this book, and here we get to the sort of new part. We spoke briefly last time about what I've said so far, but now we get into the new part. So this book is a theory of globalization, of the phenomenon that we used to refer as globalization. The French prefer the notion of mondialisation, right? Mondialization. We spoke very briefly discussing Kant, about the fact that this notion of the globe, this notion of the earth as a globe, as a whole, and maybe an integrated whole, is an Enlightenment concept, but is in fact a Kantian concept. It's not a universal concept. It has not always existed. It has existed since the Enlightenment, more or less, the European 18th century, and a certain political project that Kant for the first time launched and that goes under the name of cosmopolitanism. So So the idea of the Earth as a cosmos, right? Cosmopolitanism. The Earth understood as a cosmos, in Greek the cosmos is a harmonious whole, an integrated but harmonious whole, in which all human beings live respecting one another because of their human dignity, which is, according to Kant, an individual privilege, is constitutive of humanity, not only as a species, so to speak, but as a set of unique individuals that recognize each other as equals in terms and because of their human dignity. Okay? And so Kant, as you know, came up with the idea that if that is true, then in the end, the concept of a nation state is a concept that needs, of course, we are not talking about nation states yet. In Kant's time, we are talking about states, right? The nation state is a 19th century product. So states and their territorial boundaries are all good, but oftentimes they are in antagonistic relationship to one another. And so even if we have a period of peace in the world necessitated by peace treaties which interrupt war because of contingent interests of those states, you know, those states happen to be a period in which my interests and, you know, Ali's interests coincide. Those contingent reasons might just evaporate at any time. And so Kant was really worried about the fact that the conditions of peace determined by peace treaties were actually erected on very fragile grounds, on the grounds of the contingent convergence of interests among states. And so his cosmopolitan project was one in which he was thinking of associating, conglomerating the world states into a federation of sorts, constitutionally organized, so that these states would willingly abide by a series of rules, not as response to their contingent interests, but on moral grounds, right? In the same way that citizens abide by a constitution, not just because right now I feel like it, or Ali and I have this common interest, and so we decide to abide by a rule. But the constitution has, so to speak, also an ethical foundation. And so Kant thought, if I can have states agree to embrace a constitutional order, I can organize world society, right, in such a way that peace will become the norm and not war. Okay, I will find a way also to make peace the norm, to make peace permanent rather than temporary. That's why he wrote the essay which we read entitled Perpetual Peace. Okay? So this idea of the world as a cosmos, the idea and Kant presents project in perpetual peace of eventually disarming the world, because he feels that standing armies represent the presence of a potential threat. And so ideally we should get rid of standing armies. The idea that states are not possessions, cannot be inherited or exchanged, but the state is the property In fact, not the property, is the privilege of citizens who share a number of principles and happen to live on a certain territory. That's why Kant, in that very essay, proposes that, you know, in a world federation of states, there should be the right of visitation, namely free movement around the world. Because we do not possess any parts of the surface of the earth. Okay, we as peoples and as agents of equal dignity, of equal human dignity, do not have privileged access or possession to any parts of the earth. The earth is everyone's, but we consociate in communities, states, and empire. So why did I bring up Kant? Well, to say that this idea of the globe as such, globalization, right? As in the French, I call it mondialization. There are some theorists who make a big deal out of it. For example, Derrida, no surprise. He thinks that mondialization says it more openly, less hypocritically, what globalization is about. Because if I say globalization, the globe is simply a sphere. Okay, a sphere without a power structure embedded in it. But if I say mundus, mondialization, okay, mondialization, right, comes from mundus. The Latin mundus, which is the description of the world from the point of view of Roman rule, which is imperial rule. Okay? So Derrida thinks that to speak of mondialization is more honest than speaking about globalization. Why? Because globalization is a term that does not carry within it what Derrida, with Negri, thinks, or, you know, the same way that Negri thinks in the different theorization, that globalization entails an imperial subtext. So, okay, mondialization, cosmopolitanism. Cosmopolitanism is, what are you searching?
My umbrella, I forgot.
Your umbrella.
Yes.
You found it? So, okay, cosmopolitanism, okay, the cosmos is a harmonious whole, so in this case it's not a mundus, it's not a whole organized under the imperial rule, and it's not just a globe, okay, it is a harmonious whole. So, you know, this is just to call attention to words. We have spoken about ideology a lot in this course, particularly in relation to Arendt, and we have learned that ideas can be used politically, weaponized politically, oftentimes they get weaponized in terms of the hidden aspects of their meaning. You know, they function in different ways. And in this case, globalization, you know, both Derrida and others are right in claiming that it is taken to be a matter of fact kind of condition, right? A matter of fact condition. Well, globalization happens, you know, there has been the process of deregulation of the markets, and right now we just have it. Now, right now, you know, because of the technological progress and the process of expansion, globalization is in place. And this is really the thesis that entire cause into question. The fact that globalization is a state of affairs is a fact of the matter, and that it has an economic and communicative structure that is fundamentally apolitical. For Nangui and Hart, globalization cannot be understood as a simple process of deregulation of the markets, or as the process of communicative connection of the various points on the globe. It's not that. There is another story to be told about globalization, a complicated story, an important story that needs to be formulated, and that they try to formulate in this book. Remember that this book is part of the trilogy, Empire, Multitude, and Commonwealth is the trilogy. Okay, so we have been reading only part of the first installment of this trilogy. So yes, it is, of course, a communicative, it is, of course, a financial system. You know, globalization is both, but it's also a cultural system, it's also a, from their point of view, a juridical system. It is certainly all of this at the supranational order, supranational. It entails some degree of supersession, overcoming of the nation state. And it's most importantly an acephalous order, a decentered order. Which doesn't mean, in their analysis, that it's apolitical. It is deeply political. But it's political without a center, without a moment of foundation. We have called it the puppeteer, right? We have called it the a center, you know, a leviathan. Leviathan was Hobbes' figure for absolute sovereignty, right? Mastermind, without a real, actual mastermind. They define it also as an event. Globalization is an event. Okay, so what is an event? This text is very textured philosophically, theoretically. By that I mean that the fabric of this text is very complex. They are interweaving different references that are both historical, juridical, cultural. They are imbued with post-structuralist philosophy. We have sort of taken a quick look at the post-structuralist philosophies of Foucault and Derrida, and also Agamben, I would say, is certainly a post-structuralist. So we can say, I mean, event is one of the keywords in this panorama. It was theorized by Heidegger. Certainly by Derrida and also by Foucault. And it refers to what happens, not in terms understood as a substance, an object that persists through time, whose identity remains the same through time, but the result of a play of forces. So by event, I would say that certainly Derrida and Foucault, and practically also Heidegger, understand the outcome of a play of forces, which is not exactly a thing, right? How is it not a thing? Think about it. So I'm contrasting an object, a substance, that remains the same through time. What is an example of a substance?
A tree.
A tree? Philosophers usually say a desk. Why? Or a chair. Okay? A chair or a desk. Part of my context. Okay, so a tree, a desk, a chair. And let's contrast that to with rather an event understood as the result of a play of forces.
Basically, yeah? I would say that the event is
a little bit louder.
The event is constructed and interpreted differently and by the forces that are conflicting. So there is no eternal substance. It is a rather a process, a constant process.
There you go. So, whereas the idea of substance or object refers to either a meaning or a thing that are what they are identical with themselves, right? A tree is a tree. Of course, never tell that to a philosopher. The philosopher says a tree is not actually a tree, but you know, that's why they're so interested in substance. And by the way, it comes from substratum, Latin, and it means what lies under, okay? What lies under sun. So what lies under is this identity that persists through time, right? That remains the same, that is self-identical. Whereas if you think of an event as the result of a play of forces, it's much more dynamic, right? You're talking about a dynamic. Remember I told you that you cannot imagine a force by itself, right? In order to have a force, you're going to have two forces. So you're already talking about a dynamics. You're already talking about something that can be interpreted in terms of, right? At least two forces. So let's think about the author, for example, Foucault, an author that we have studied. And let's try to bring that to life with respect to Foucault's philosophy. So what is an event for Foucault? Give me an example of an event. So that we have the example of the tree, or the desk, or the chair. And now, thinking of Foucault, give me an example of an event. Mm-hmm. Yovita? We're trying to contrast the substance and event, right?
Event.
Event.
I mean, like
in the Foucaultian world, what is an event?
Like birth.
What's that?
Birth of something.
The birth of something. Okay. What did we discuss? What was born for Foucault at a certain point in time that didn't quite exist before?
In the same way. Like the governmentality issue?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So give me an example. Institutions, yeah. Andrews?
Let's say the rise of the middle class.
All right, give me a Foucaultian example.
Industrial power, yeah.
Power, yeah.
Industrial power.
Right.
And maybe sexualism.
What's that?
Sexuality.
Sexuality, yeah. Okay, madness, for example, right? Remember, we spoke about the birth of madness. Now, what does he mean, the birth of madness? He means that in his analysis, madness is an event because we can understand it as the product of what? As the product of?
Of sanity.
Right, of a certain definition of sanity, right? Of normal. So, the idea of normality, of sanity, emerges at the same time and produces its other, right, which is what is not normal, what is mad, that then produces a certain institution, which is the asylum. So in effect, madness is not a substance, it's not identical with itself, but emerges precisely in opposition to its other. Yeah?
But, I mean, one could object that actually it doesn't really matter to draw a distinction between substance and event, because in the end they're just two sides of the same coin. I mean, they are, I would say, part of being. Being could be substance and can be also event.
All right. What is absolute? But what does, what, for example, what does Foucault cash out? What does he get out of this theorization of this thinking in terms of the event? Thinking of concepts, for example, not as identical with themselves, but as the result of the play of forces. What does he get that he wouldn't get thinking of madness as substance? Which would mean we know what madness means. Because there is something called man and something called normal. And man is about madness and normality is about normality. And how could I decide where the boundary is? Well, you know, someone does not know how to distinguish between good and evil, they're mad. If someone knows how to distinguish between good and evil, they're normal. Which of course requires me to know what good and evil is, right? So what do you cash out? What do you get? Yeah.
Well, I don't know much about Foucault, but I
that's
think
fine, that's fine.
You cash out to that you understand that to understand what madness is, you have to take into consideration the whole context in which that in which the madness is the product. I mean, the which
yeah.
madness is
good
place, and so all the different forces that are in play, and just the historical period, and all the different sorts of aspects. In which otherwise maybe you would think, no, madness is, we just need to get a medical definition or something, which for him is not.
Okay, very good. So what you get is a contextualization, is the contextual value of tasks, right? It reveals how the context behind the emergence of certain concepts, of certain events, right? And thus reveals how relative they are, right? And how relational they are. Because once you say mad, you're also saying normal. Once you say criminal, you're also saying non-criminal, right? And so you're showing how a certain event, a linguistic event, a conceptual event, stands in relation to other things, right? It's never an absolute in isolation identical to itself, but it has meaning insofar as it relates to other things.
And also how culturally we are determined to think dichotomously.
Dichotomously, yeah.
Dichotomously.
Of course. Okay, all of that is true. All right, so is an event, okay, empire is an event. All right, for Langley and Hart, is an event in the sense that it is not identical with itself. It's not something. But it is a force. It is the result of a play of forces that push in one direction. Okay? So we're not talking about a state of affairs. We're not talking about an objective. I think we actually left the last class. Remember we spoke about the fact that Negri and Wright think that this emerging order has to do with the transition from the sovereign right of nations to a unified global right that they define as an imperial right. In that global right, imperial right, whose act of birth they locate in the 17th century with the Peace of Westphalia, that closes the 30 Years' War, they also relate with the situation of crisis. They feel that this international order that began with the Peace of Westphalia in the 17th century, that entails the transition from the right of sovereign nation states to a global kind of juridical body, is also an order that is in crisis. But we said, and we kind of ended there, that's why you asked for more, and I said, okay, yeah, this is no question on which to end. They also say that empire feeds on crisis. Remember? So what does that mean? That the crisis of the international order, which has to do with that transition from the sovereignty of nation states to some sort of international global sovereignty that has imperial colorations. Okay? That order which is in crisis feeds empire. That empire feeds on that crisis of that order.
Which crisis?
Which crisis? Of the international order. Okay. Sovereign right of nation states. Fine. Peace of Westphalia. There are no nation states then. There are states. But those states become in the 19th century nation states. But since the Peace of Westphalia, which is the first modern diplomatic congress, according to Argentinian historians, for a number of reasons that we're not explore right now, there begins an international, the idea of an international order, okay? International law. As the centuries go by and modernity develops, this international order becomes both stronger and weaker. Stronger because the need for it becomes more pressing, but weaker because we have the First World War and then the Second World War, right? And the need to integrate the right of sovereign nation states becomes stronger and stronger, okay? So yes, there is the League of Nations after World War I, and then there is the United Nations after World War II. You know, institutions that try to, in a way, constitutionalize international law, right? And to strengthen that international order. But in the end, we all agree that they aren't enough and that order is in crisis. The problem hasn't been solved. What Negri and the more so, they're writing in 2000, after a series of financial crises, after the intensification of the network of communication, right, and the deregulation of the markets. The order is in crisis. But their claim is that empire feeds on that crisis. The more crisis there is, and the more empire there is. Okay, so we have to explain why, how they substantiate this claim. Okay, their claim is that and I go back to the very first words of empire, the very opening of the book, which is the problematic of empire is determined in the first place by one simple fact, that there is world order. This order is expressed as a juridical formation. This is the opening of the book. So there is world order, and that world order is spelled out in terms of a juridical formation. The simple idea, okay, which is not that simple, but a way of hopefully explaining what I was saying before, namely, which is the fundamental intuition of the book, that the more crisis of international order there is, and the more empire there is. Is that where, whenever there is a crisis around the world, what they call the juridical order that organizes the world, which is expressed mostly by the United Nations Charter, intervenes. Right? Whenever there is a crisis, the world order intervenes, and by intervening, increases its power. By intervening, specifies the conditions under which it acts, its own legislation. And so the more it intervenes, and the more... So empire, they write, is called into being as the need arises to solve conflicts. So that its expansion, the expansion of empire, is rooted in the internal trajectory of the conflicts it is meant to resolve. Therefore, the terrain of empire is the terrain of crisis, which is in turn the terrain of exception. Only in the name of exception can unitarily control a fluid situation. Okay, so the more crisis there is around the world, the more intervention there is, the more empire there is. Now, I will backpedal a minute now and give you a little gloss on Negri and Hart's reconstruction of the space in which the UN Charter was formulated. Because that is important to understand what they're doing. In empire. Yeah?
But then couldn't you say that it's not truly a crisis, but it's a super, it's a superficial crisis, and structurally it isn't a crisis because if the system is still stable in a way, leading in this crisis, then it's sort of the mask of what, I mean, the crisis is kind of like what justifies the whole system to keep going, so it's not really a crisis. I mean, it's a juridical crisis, but that's kind of like a superstructure, you can say.
Well, you could say that in some cases, I mean, let's think concretely about situations such as the war in Kosovo, for example, okay? And UN intervention there. Okay, what are your thoughts about that? So was that a real crisis? Or was it even a real crisis? The question is, I said that Amy and Hart believe that the empire feeds on crisis because every time there is a crisis, it intervenes and thus reinforces itself.
But it's a local crisis, and it's not the crisis of the system.
So right. I am actually reiterating your question so that the class is with us, right? And so the question is, but is that a local crisis? So that actually they are claiming that the empire feeds on crisis is not actually accurate, or is it a real crisis, in which case it is accurate? Yeah, Jacqueline?
No, I believe that it is a natural crisis because before the crisis, actually, the empire does not control that particular place, that particular state, and after and through the crisis, empire have access to, for instance, Kosovo and all the area of Eastern Europe.
And thus extends.
And therefore, it's also, I would say, a territorial expansion from a certain point of view, because through the crisis, you gain access, empire gains access. So,
but how can you say that it didn't already have access to the area? I mean, it
did. You know, for instance, I will say as an example, after the fall of the Berlin Wall, Russia was not a domain to which empire had access, but through the crisis, it gained access also of Russia and Eastern Europe. And it was not a fake crisis, actually. It was a concrete crisis.
I thought the whole story began after the
Well, okay. So, no, it doesn't. I mean, the book was written after the Berlin Wall fell. But their analysis of empire is... crystallizes around their assessment of the role of the UN, okay? As the first form, as the first phase of the juridification of international relations, okay? So, no, actually, their analysis starts in 1946. And that's why I want to backpedal now and tell you what is their genealogy of the UN Charter so that your question, you know, gets an answer at this point. Because what they actually think is that this order, in a way, began with the Peace of Westphalia, in a way, you know, in a very, so to speak, immature and almost unrecognizable form, the Peace of Westphalia gave you know, began this whole process, which is dominated by a figure in the 20th century that they deem to be very, very important, whose name is Hans Helsing. Okay, so an Austrian-American jurist and the author of a book entitled The Pure Theory of Law that came out in 1934, emigrated to the United States and became one of the theorists behind the UN Charter. Now, it's interesting that Kelsen, as a jurist, was very, very influenced by Kant. Okay, remember that I said that the UN Charter is possibly the most Kantian political document that was ever written. It may be the political document if you exclude maybe the constitution of some socialist state, you know, which of course has Marx behind it, possibly the political document which has a philosopher as an inspiring sort of figure behind it. So what about Kelsen? Kelsen saw the international order is not only normative with respect to the domestic law of the nation states, but is ethically normative. That is the Kelsen foundation, okay? So not only normative with respect to the domestic law of nation states, so the domestic law of nation states would recognize the normative power of the international order. But that the international order, according to Kelsen, had to have ethical authority and ethical, intrinsic ethical validity. Remember that Kant had that, right? For Kant, law is not just a way of producing violence. It has intrinsic ethical value. So obviously there is a great influence of Kant and the Enlightenment in Kelsen, who conceives of the United Nations as an organization of humanity that aims at being one with the supreme ethical idea of justice. The project of achieving, end quote, a universal community superior to the particular states, enveloping them all within itself, is the political correlative of the supreme ethical idea. So for Kelsen, the UN organized a rational idea, which means the base of effectiveness for a schema for an organization that has intrinsic value. Okay? All states are equal, have equal dignity in relation to one another, and precisely that recognition is the ethical value, not only the juridically normative value with respect to other juridical orders, but the ethical value of this organization, of this constitution. All right? So Negri and Hart say, in its attempt to constitutionalize its supranational sovereignty, the UN allowed the juridical concept of empowerment to take shape. Okay, so in its attempt to constitutionalize its supranational sovereignty, the UN allowed the juridical concept of empire to take space, to take place. So empire, the book, empire, the political project of Negri and Hart, the political theory, conceives of itself as a tailored response to the project of the UN as a new global power. Okay? So empire, the political project, is a response to the UN as a new global power. That's what the project is about. So in effect, imperial sovereignty, the kind of sovereignty that empire expresses. Remember that empire is capitalized, right, always, and without an article. It's not the empire or an empire, it's just empire. And I'd like to hear, after I say this, why do you think this is relevant? So if empire exercises sovereignty that is different from state sovereignty, both Negri and Hart say there is a paradigm shift here. And the paradigm has to do with the transition from sovereignty to law. Okay? In imperial sovereignty, is grounded in law rather than in politics. Okay, having said this, why do you think empire, spelled in the capitalized way without the heart, is relevant in this context?